processes. And I want to tell you what kind of wood Noah was supposed to make that ark out of. He was going to make it out of gopher wood. Y'all ever heard of gopher wood? I used to make a joke about that. That's old rat wood. A gopher is a rat, isn't it? That's a bad joke. But it was gopher wood. And God told Noah, said, I want you to make that ark out of gopher wood. And I want you to make it this long, and this wide, and this tall. And oh, you're going to make three decks in there. There'll be a lower deck, a middle deck, and a top deck. And he said, when you get this done, well, actually, while you're doing it, put one window in it, way up here. And put one door in it. I want y'all to notice this is where our door is going to be tonight. Because when we get ready to build this ark, we're going to need a door to go in. And so, Noah listened to God. He did exactly what God said. He went and got gopher wood, and he started building that ark. And it took him a long time to build it. I mean, this wasn't something he built overnight anyway. But Noah hung in there, and he built that ark. And he got it all finished up. And I can just imagine Noah probably looked around as he was getting through. Wow, this is starting to look pretty neat. You know, got a big boat here. And then God told him, said, okay, it's time. I want you to get all the animals to go in here now. Y'all remember how many animals were in? I mean, how many of each kind? Two of each kind. In fact, the ones that were called clean animals, the ones they could eat, were seven of them. But we're gonna just call it two now. Now that meant, what's your favorite animal? What animal do you like? Cows? What's your favorite animals? Monkeys? Dogs? Cats? I like it, we're getting different. What's your favorite animal? A cat? What's your favorite animal? Well, okay, well, what's your favorite animal? I want you to be thinking of it, because whatever your favorite animal is, that's what? A what? A kitty? Whatever your favorite animal is, that's what you're going to be when we go into the ark. Because we're about to fill up that ark. God told Noah, I want you to get two of each kind. So there would be two dogs and two cats and two cows and two everything. I didn't hear anybody call a hippopotamus. That's kind of fun to say, isn't it? Come on around. So if you're a hippopotamus, you got to have two hippopotamuses. How do you say that? Come on in. And so, They each had to get together, and when I was y'all's age, I was in a little kid's class that Brother Robert's daddy taught. Now this is true, this was years ago. And he told this very same story. And he said, when they started going in, he said, how long did they come? There was two dogs. And then there was two cats. And there were two monkeys, and there were two hippopotamuses, and there were two elephants, and there were two everything. And you could just look at all the animals in the world, and we won't have time to do anywhere near all of them tonight. But I want us to fill that ark with the very animals that would have gone in when Noah loaded up that ark. And when God said, okay, it's time, we're going to load up the ark. So, y'all just came in. I had everybody else think, what's your favorite animal? So, what's your favorite animal? How about you? What's your favorite animal? A bird. Oh, birds went in there too. I didn't think of that. Yeah. What's your favorite animal? Do you like the animals, and God closed the door. I think that kind of neat. God closed the door on that ark because he didn't want it to leak. Because it's about to come a big, big rain. And I mean, it's going to rain and rain for 40 days and 40 nights. I think the longest I ever remember seeing it rain myself is like a week. And even that wasn't solid. But can you imagine it raining real hard for 40 days and 40 nights? That's exactly what God caused to happen. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights, and the water started coming up. And what do you think happened with that ark? It floated. When the water got up around it, if this were the ark, all of a sudden we'd start doing this number. Oh, man, we're riding the waves. And that's exactly what happened. And that's how God saved Noah and his family and all the animals that were in there. And so they didn't die in the flood. If they had been outside the ark, they would have drowned. God was protecting life, and he kept them all safe. And then, of course, when the flood is over, they were able to come back out on dry ground, and they were able to replenish the earth. And they started back over again, kind of. And that's how God saved the world and saved the animals that are in the world. At a time when he got rid of the wicked people, they are no more. The good people were there, and the good animals were there. They were ready to start a new life. And so I think that's pretty neat, the way God saved the people at that time. Okay, our time's about up. I want us to sing one or two songs with all y'all. And then we'll begin. This is our singing night, so you boys will be able to lead a song if you like it. We'll get through this. Well, let's start with Jesus Loves Me. We all know that song. Y'all ready to sing? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. And one more song before we close the class this evening. Let's sing This Little White Man. You know that's right. That represents our influence. You know the influence of other people. You may not even know it. Somebody's watching. When you do something good, they say, "Ah, that was something good. I think I need to do that." Unfortunately, if we ever do something bad, they say, "Oh, that's bad. They might want to do that." We don't want to do the bad things, do we? We want to do the good life. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine all the time. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine all the time. Satan's not gonna get out, I'm gonna let it shine. Satan's not gonna get out. I'm gonna let it shine all the time. Put it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine. Put it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine all the time. Read my Bible every day, that will make it shine. Read my Bible every day, that will make it shine all the time. Go to church and Sunday school, that will make it shine. Go to church and Sunday school, that will make it shine all the time. Y'all do very good. Okay, we're going to start the singing. Do all you boys have a song up your head? Okay. I don't know who wants to go first. You want to go first? Well, come on. And I don't know what song you want to sing. What do you want to sing?
What?
Say it loud. have 10,000 angels? I'm talking to them back there. We're going to need to. We want everybody else to have the same, so we want.
I've heard it before.
If you happen to know the song, number. Oh, look at that. 10,000 angels.
621.
They're better than I am. All right. You want to start it?
Yep.
Okay. Let's go.
Oh,
So what that means is y'all got another substitute song leader. I want to say to you little kids, actually, most of y'all are not little kids, you're big kids, but y'all brought back some wonderful memories to me. It's been many, many, many years since I've taught that little kids class, but y'all made me proud and y'all did wonderful. A class like that's great to teach. Our first song be number 583. Sing to me of heaven. And let's start at the back. Brother Eric, would you lead next? And then Mason, and then work our way forward after that. So after I lead this song, I'm going to ask Brother Joe Polk to lead us in prayer after this song, and then Brother Eric, you will lead next.
Sing to me of heaven, sing. Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
number 66 in the big book, number 66.
Joy like a fountain. What's the lead next? Like we went through everybody. We got lost on leaders missing. So sing out. I'll go ahead and do a couple. Next one comes up, do a couple more. Number one.
Each day I live. Yeah.
273.
Mad at me if you had to listen to me again. You could have had him, but I want to think for just a moment. Oh, for those of you who may not be sports fans, I want to tell you a story. For those of you who are, you'll maybe be reminded. On June the 2nd, 2010, Armando Galarraga took the mound for the Detroit Tigers versus the Cleveland Indians. And for many of you, that may not mean much of anything at all, and you may be thinking, I can't even say that name again. Well, don't worry about it, because what transpired over the events of that game is what really matters. See, going into the ninth inning, Galarraga was pitching a no-hitter. For those of you who don't know what a no-hitter is, that means nobody hit. But his no-hitter was special. It was actually even grander. It was a perfect game. In other words, at this point in the game, he had faced 24 batters, and he got 24 outs. No one had got on base. No one had hit. Nobody had got walked. Nobody got hit by a batter, by a pitch. It's the perfect game. He has pitched immaculately. Well, going into the ninth inning, the first guy comes up. He throws a fastball, pop fly, wall. There it goes. It's about to go out. His perfect game's almost over. Center fielder makes an outstanding catch over his shoulder. One out. He's two outs away from a perfect game. Next guy comes up, ground ball, shortstop, out at first base. He is one out from a perfect game. Ground ball on the right side of the field. The first baseman goes to make the play. Galarraga himself, who is pitching the perfect game, goes to cover first base. He gets the ball, catches the ball, runner's foot hits the bag. First base umpire calls him safe. The look of distraught on everyone's field. It is hands on head all across the field. No one can believe what just happened. He blew it. He blew the game. And many people say, well, it's not one call that makes a difference. This was the last out. This was it. If that out is called, it's a perfect game. He goes down in the history books. Just to tell you how historic this event is, had that perfect game been recorded, that would have been the 21st perfect game in the history of Major League Baseball. So if you go to 20,000 games, you might see one perfect game. Since 1908, 23 perfect games have been pitched up to now. He would have been number 21. He takes the mound, he goes back, and he gets the next guy out. That's it. Of course, at the end of the game, they're congratulating him, but what are they really congratulating him for? I mean, it doesn't have the taste that it was going to have. And in perfect Major League Baseball fashion, the entire bench clears out, and the manager, who have all now seen this replay and known, and now they know that he blew the call. He really was out. That poor umpire is trying to make it off the field. Jim Joyce is his name. And he tries to make it off the field, and everyone is letting him know in Major League fashion that he blew that call. And for an invitation, that really means absolutely nothing. And you needed to hear that to understand what happens the next night. Of course, this umpire goes back, and he watches the game film of all of his calls and realizes that he blew this guy's name going down in history. He messed it. He missed it. He owned it up in an interview. He said, "I missed it. I missed the call. But there's nothing that I can do about it now. It's over." The next night, Galarraga, whose perfect game was ruined, they meet before the game and exchange lineups. Jim Joyce, who was the first base umpire, is now the home plate umpire and the crew chief. He's in charge of the umpires and the orchestra of the game. And Galarraga brings the lineup out to Jim Joyce. Jim Joyce's eyes fill with tears, and Galarraga gives him a great big hug and walks back to the dugout. In the moment, Galarraga was mad, sad, and brokenhearted. I mean, he had that taken away from him. A rightful call out would put his name in the history books. But instead, he's the greatest almost perfect game story in Major League Baseball. But his attitude toward the umpire of saying, "It's okay, I forgive you," is a lesson that we can all take to heart. Because we've all been mad, sad, and brokenhearted by someone somewhere along life's way. In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13, it says, "Forgive one another just as Christ has forgiven you." When we think about everything that we have been forgiven, we have no reason to hold anything back from forgiving someone for a wrong that they may have done to us. If I think about one of the greatest wrongs done in history, I think about Peter and how he, on the night before Christ is betrayed, he's saying, I want to die with you. I will go to battle with you. You are never going to die. I will take care of this. Only before the rooster crows the next morning, he had denied Christ three times. I'm sure Christ felt mad, sad, and brokenhearted from Peter. If you remember Peter's reaction in Matthew 26, verse 75, he goes out and weeps bitterly, realizing the sin that he had done to Christ, how he had denied him, how he himself in a like manner had also betrayed him and forsook him, saying, "I don't even know the man." And we are all guilty of sin against God. And that sin has separated us from God. But Christ went to the cross not only for Peter, but also for the whole world. Because all of our sin has got Jesus disappointed, sad, and brokenhearted. But yet, Christ forgives us. Now, can we have the same attitude of forgiveness, not only with our brethren as Christ forgave us, but also have we taken the forgiveness that God has given to us, an opportunity to be mended and whole and justified and sanctified before Him through the blood of Jesus Christ? This evening we have an opportunity for you, if you are not a child of God, to become one, to be baptized into the watery grave of baptism, being washed and cleansed and seen justified, and this is above all things, totally forgiven and accepted by God. If you're here this evening and you're not a Christian, we invite you to come as we stand and as we sing.
There's a great day coming, a great day coming, there's a great day coming by and by, when the saints and the sinners shall be parted right and left. Are you ready for that day to come? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? There's a bright day coming, a bright day coming, there's a bright day coming by and by, but its brightness shall only come to them that love the Lord. Are you ready for that day to come? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? There's a sad day coming, a sad day coming, there's a sad day coming by and by, when the sinner shall hear his soon depart, I know he not. Are you ready for that day to come? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day?
Please be seated.
Is there anyone here this evening that hadn't had an opportunity to partake of the Lord's Supper?
I want to thank each of you for being here this evening. To those of you who joined us online, we are thankful to have you as well. I know I didn't do as good as Matt, but I'm telling you, this was a wonderful service. I meant what I said about the kids' class a while ago. I have not taught that in many, many years. I've lost track of how many years it's been. But that was a wonderful class. And those students are wonderful. And you parents, hang in there. You're doing a good job. Let's keep it going. Let's all remember our Wednesday evening service at 7 o'clock. Let's try to be back for that service. Are there any announcements that anyone needs to make? Brother Bruce Nelson, would you lead us in our closing prayer, please?
Lord, thank you for this day and all this many blessings. Thank you for bringing us here tonight to have another song service. Lord, we ask that you be with the sick and shut in and help them get back to their most wanted need. Help be thy will. We go into the coming week, Lord, be with us and guard our hearts. Bring us back here at the next point in time. Go with us now to God's heart for us in the end. We've been found faithful. Please give us company in heaven. Please give us our sin. Jesus.
Amen. And then they take some collars.
What are you feeding him? He's smarter than me.
Chicken nuggets and french fries. So, almost exclusively.